Thank you very much for inviting me here. It's of course a pleasure to be with all of you, also with this very beautiful view on the right, which I'm not accustomed to have, even in Paris. So thank you very much. So for the next 40 minutes or so, I will speak a little bit about what we did at LexiFi. Of course, it will be a little bit egocentric because I will speak about what we did, about ourselves. But the idea is to give you an overview, and I will of course be open to all questions. So in fact, it's very simple. We are speaking here about complex financial contracts, about bespoke financial contracts, all these horrible things that you have read about very much during the last years of this crisis. Of course, LexiFi has been founded many years before the crisis. But it's about this kind of contracts that we are speaking here. So we are speaking here about investment bank activity and not the retail banking that you may know from your own own investments. And so there's a very, very simple question. Did this industry, which as you know is important and huge, did it create a formal and precise way to describe these financial contracts? And in fact, the birth of LexiFi is on the constatation that this was not the fact. And so there's a quote I very much like to present, which is one of the rare cases I know about where at the highest level, where at the CEO level, it was admitted that simply there was no precise description of the contracts available, and so that it was only personal knowledge of the traders in the company that was available, and so it was very, very difficult to replace these human beings because they were the only people that know about the contract. And this is one of the one of these citations following some investigation about the financial crisis. So it's a rare moment of honesty in this financial industry because it is very difficult to obtain this kind of citations. And in other hearings, one has heard other people of the financial industry explaining that there was no available common language for describing financial contracts or derivatives in this respect. And there should be a common language for doing this kind of thing. So really, the industry practice is that, of course, contracts are often bespoke, are often complex. The biggest profit is, of course, in the segment of the most tailored contract. These contracts are lasting for many years. We are not speaking about contracts that are in a book for 2 months or 3 months. They often last for 5 years, for 8 years, even 10 years or even more. Many different kind of treatments must be applied to these kind of contracts. As we have heard a few minutes ago, valuation is one of these treatments, very important, and of course where we need some kind of high performance approach for evaluating this beast, which are asking for some numerical, non-completely trivial methodologies. But there are many other treatments that have to be applied, and this has to be applied from inception up to maturity of this product, so maybe for the next 10 years. And a financial institution, the big financial institutions, typically have many of these contracts in their books, hundreds, thousands of books contracts in books, which are typically managed by small groups of human beings. And the large computer programs which are available, which are used at these institutions, typically either ignore the precise semantics of these contracts, because they just incorporate some, I would say, salient features, or they need huge and very difficult and very error-prone extensions which are hand-programmed and which are very often needs 6 months or 1 year, in other words, an eternity in a very, very quickly advancing industry like finance. And so the typical description of these financial contracts is called a term sheet. And term sheets are kind of informal contract descriptions that are available, that are exchanged between banks, between financial institutions. And from what we have observed in this industry for the last 10 years is that each term sheet contains at least one error. It's a kind of axiom that we have found, as they typically are either incomplete, inconsistent, contradictory, contain implicit rules, whatever. The typical problem of informal specifications, which are applied here in the term sheet stuff. Of course, this fundamental axiom of financial engineering is wrong. It's not completely true, because the LexiFi solution allows now to create also term sheets automatically from a specification. And so there exist term sheets which have no errors, but there are only very few of them in the market. Okay, so the business concerns typically are that the financial institutions are looking for systems that allow to design, to price, to process heterogeneous, that's very important. Heterogeneous meaning that contracts of different kinds, it's not so much the individual complexity of each contract, it's the fact that they have small differences, small little differences, a framework that scales so that they can manipulate many of these contracts. Automation of the full product life cycle from prototyping to maturity, of course, includes contract documentation, term sheet generation. Also, there must be a secured agreement on contract between the two parties, which must agree very precisely on the terms of the contract, kind of handshaking protocol, if you want. Contract must be evaluated and clearly, as you have read in the newspapers, regulation, oversight, so it's called regulatory pressure in this industry, is becoming bigger and bigger, and so banks must produce more and more documents or expose more and more their positions. And so what is the challenge that we see here is to create a contract or a product or bespoke contract definition language which can be read by human beings and which can be read, of course, by a computer, and that satisfies mainly three goals, to describe the rights and obligations in a very precise way, contains all the semantics of the contract, that lends to manipulations of all sorts, not only pricing, but also pricing and many other things, and that reflect the evolution of the contract over time, because these contracts, they are beginning now and then they are slowly transforming, they are slowly simplifying as uncertainty resolves, as fixings of observables are done and things like that. And so typically, of course, and we are coming back to the topic of this workshop, we are here again in something where a domain-specific language is typically, probably, an interesting solution. And what we did at LexiFi is, of course, to build up a contract algebra, kind of algebra with a minimalistic set of combinators. We want all this to be compositional for evident reasons, for being able to have as big and as large contract descriptions as we want, so that we can have a clear semantics of this of a contract description once we know precisely what each combinator means. And also we want this contract algebra, we want a description, a contract description, to be a value so that it can be itself manipulated, transformed, that we can create a new description from an existing one and things like that. And again, important is syntax here is minor, it's all about semantics. The initial paper, which was mentioned by Todd, was very Haskell oriented. We have now switched to OCaml, but as you will see, we could use many other tools. That's not fundamentally. It's about this algebra. And so, just to give you a little example that you see, it's the only example I will give you without going in all the details. But here, the contract, which is defined, which is called C, means that you acquire at a certain date, which is here, the January the 2th of 2010. You acquire what? You acquire the right to choose between a finite number of possibilities. That's this either construction, which has as an argument a list. And here, this list contains only two possibilities. One possibility being to abandon. So you see the possibilities are annotated with strings, some kind of labels, how we name the different choices. And we can either abandon, and then we receive the zero contract, which is kind of neutral element of our contract algebra, a contract without any rights and obligations attached to it, or we receive a cash flow in a given currency and from a given value, meaning that this is the value of the fixing here of an equity, which could be anything. I call it XYZ, an equity, and because it's a call, it's the level of the equity at a given date minus what is called the strike. And so you have the right or not to exercise this option. And this is here a cash settled, meaning that if you exercise, you receive money, you don't receive physically an equity. So it's a cash settled for simplicity. Here, a call with discretionary exercise decision, meaning that the holder of this contract really has to choose if he exercises or not. Because of course, I could also write a contract where I would simply say to you, if the underlying is fixing higher than the strike, then I will pay you the difference. But that's not the case here. Here, it's really a discretionary choice. So that's just for showing you an example of a very simple example. The previous definition we have seen, and that's important, it contains no reference to any pricing model, no reference to any idea how to evaluate this contract. And I think that the big problem, or one of the big problems of the finance industry, is that everything is immediately thought out in terms of pricing, which is the most complex usage, of course, of these financial contracts. But one should see pricing as just being one application that has to be done with complex contracts. We do it, of course, we'll come back about that, but pricing is just one application. So here there are no mathematical notions. So we are just saying, we are just describing precisely what the holding of one unit of this contract means. We say exactly what are the rights and obligations of this contract for the holder of the contract. Basta. No maths, no stochastic integration, no Itô lemma, no risk neutral evaluation, and all these kind of things you know in finance. No, it's just what is the contract meaning. No reference to any max operator, but because typically when you evaluate an option, you very quickly have some max operator involved. So here, nothing from that. That's all. So it's a self-contained contract logic description. Of course, for understanding this contract, we have to know very precisely the meaning of the different combinators we have been using. Here, acquire, either, and this kind of things. Like, if I write an algebraic expression, of course, we need to agree on the meaning of the symbols, plus, minus, parentheses, etc., etc., etc. So, again, and this is, of course, something completely usual to people in this audience, such a contract description can typically be represented as in the form of an abstract syntax tree, like we have done it here, a little bit simplified, of course, And you see typically the analogy we very often explain to people about a financial contract and an algebraic expression like you see it here on the right. Of course, all these combinators need to be well understood. They have an informal description which we provide to our customers. These combinators are some kind of are derived and extended with respect to the initial paper which was mentioned. And of course, you need to understand very well all these combinators. So here we give the signature, the arguments of a few of them, just the minimalistic set of combinators so that you understand, that you are able to understand well the simple code example in the preceding slide. But what is important is that today, depending on how you are counting, of course, there are between 15 and 20 combinators. So everything, all contracts are described with this little set of combinators that, of course, you have to understand well. But everything, it's the kind, I would say, these 20 combinators, and of course, all this algebra is, I would say, the machine language of the LexiFi system. Everything at the end is expressed in terms of these 15-20 combinators, and all our contract manipulation machinery is in fact written as recursive traversal of these abstract syntax trees and doing, of course, the appropriate operations related to these combinators. So before I go further, I want to speak a little bit about the technical choices that we have done at LexiFi. So this has nothing to do with the concept of the contract algebra, because the contract algebra, these 20 combinators, that's theory. You could write them and then implement them in Java, in C Sharp, in Standard ML, in Scala, whatever. So what are the choices we have done? We put much emphasis on controlling all our compilation chain. So we control, we have access to our own compiler that we are modifying, that we are extending. We consider that this is a strategic, is of strategic importance for our company. Especially as more and more our clients are asking us to run on heterogeneous architectures, so we are running more and more on Windows, of course, on Windows machines, 32-bit, 64-bit, on servers, on workstations, on Linux, on Solaris. Some customers have very specific demands in terms of security, in terms of what is the libc that you are using and this kind of things. And this we can only, of course, respond to if we control everything. Most of our code is implemented in what we call MLFi, which is this an extended version of the OCaml compiler. Of course, many of we are giving back to the community many things, so we are extending our language, and then we are trying as much as possible to give this back to the OCaml community for integration in the standard OCaml compiler. MLFi is used, and that's always a bit complex to understand for our clients, it's used for both things. It is using for hosting this contract algebra, but the example you have seen before was in MLFi, okay? But it's also the language, because it's also a general purpose language, it's also the language we are using for implementing more or less everything, okay? So we are using just one language at LexiFi. And in fact, for embedding these domain-specific combinators, we are using a two-staged approach where, in fact, yes, one is building, when the user is defining, in fact, the internal representation of a contract by producing an MLFi program which generates this internal representation. in fact, it's more or less a one-to-one association between the combinators and one function that is creating one of the abstract tree nodes. But these functions are checking many invariants, are doing many error checkings, and etc. etc. But the typical user don't see this difference. And in fact, the host language is used to implement what we call an instrument, which is a function which goes from parameters, from a given set of parameters, to a given contract. Because contracts are typically parameterized. You have a swap, for instance, a swap, yes, you have a denomination, you have a maturity, you have a periodicity, which may be monthly, trimestrial, or whatever. And you want this to have as a parameter. And the instrument code also contains many non-financial information about the GUI generation, about what we call calculated attributes, etc., etc. So with time, this has been extended more and more. And of course, having control over the compiler is here for us fundamental stuff. So we are able to export typing information to other tools and reuse them, etc. And so typically, just for showing you an example, it's not you don't see it very clearly here, but just for showing to you that, of course, we are speaking here about a nice DSL and about the transformations and invariants and axioms, etc. But for the typical end user, at the end, it's just an application. And here you have the editing of some parameters, and of course, behind that, there's all this machinery of this DSL. Okay? Now, once we have elaborated these combinators and we are beginning to write contracts, yes, of course, we can also think and write down some rewriting rules. So here I have put the most simple rewriting rules where we implement simply the fact that we are simplifying contracts. So typically the all combinator is meaning that you have all of the contracts you are long, and of course having the zero element is typically something that you can simplify out of the all combinator, like you can simplify out adding zero to something else. In fact, the giving a given contract is coming back to the initial contract, etc., etc. Just to show to you that once you have build up such an algebra, you can build up these rewriting rules. Of course, in our system, they are much more than that, but it's not more than writing this kind of things. And then it's also always very pleasant because it's always a way to hire some PhD students to think about this kind of rewriting rules, to prove invariance, to maybe use some theorem prover on some subset of these rewriting rules and things like that. Yes, it's always nice. It keeps the company, I would say, young and always academically interesting. Another way reasoning about contract definitions, it's also to, for instance, collecting the future cash flows. It means simply you have a contract and you want to have an overview of what will be the certain or uncertain cash flows that will be paid out or that you have to pay. Okay? So, of course, depending on our needs, we can define a semantics which is very precise or not so precise. But let's say it in a very, I write just a few examples and without, of course, going in the details. This is a way to collect all the cash flows which appear in the contract. And the only important thing here is that we want not only to have the list of cash flows, therefore the currency, the value can be a symbolic value because you don't know always an exact amount, remember this European call I showed you before. You only know that if you receive it, it will be the difference between a fixing of XYZ and the strike. But also you want, in this example, to know if you will receive this cash flow for sure, or if it depends on some decision, on some exercise decision. And so here, this is the semantics of the future cash flows with uncertainty flag, which is added here, which means that if I am in an IVA, if I'm under an IVA contract, my paid out cash flows become uncertain. So I have here this true Boolean indicator. So just to show to you that once you have this algebra, you begin to build up procedures which of course have to work for all contracts that you describe with it, but it's not, you are naturally, you ask the right questions. Having such an algebra at least forces you always to ask the good question. You don't have always the good answer, but at least, or not immediately, but at least you know what you are speaking about. Similar, or I would say in an extended view, is what we call the future calendar of a contract, which is not only the future cash flows, but all future events that may happen in this contract. One has to remember to the user that in 1 year he will have to choose, he will have to exercise an option. Or we have to check that a barrier, what is called a barrier, is not hit, that not a given underlying the Euro Stoxx 50 is not hitting a certain value. Blah, blah, blah. We have many things like that. And so, of course, this is very similar, but a little bit more complex than going through all the abstract syntax tree and collecting information. And so, how does this appear in the application? Just for you to see a little bit. So here we have a graphical user interface. That's the Windows application, and where we have chosen for a given contract, which is here, we have chosen to show the internal contract representation. And so this is of course for power users. The usual user is not looking at that. So we see here a textual representation of the abstract syntax tree of the contract, and here we can look at what we call the schedule, which is this calendar I showed you before, which gives me the list of fixings to do, some buyers which are here, and the future cash flows I have shown you before. Just to show you how these nice ideas then appear in an application, which is here. Of course, our technology users, the people who are licensing the libraries, they are not doing any GUI like that. They have access to some functions that return in a programmatic way and representation of the calendar, which we represent here just by a GUI. Managing a contract, meaning that I have, for instance, to record the fact that I do a certain choice by executing a contract, is very simple. It's just, by analogy, it's the same as transforming an abstract syntax tree. It's like saying I have here an algebraic expression, and when y is equal to 2, I can simplify it, period. And managing a contract in our system is exactly the same thing, even if, of course, everything is a bit more complex. You have to be very careful, but the idea is exactly the same. And so here I show you, this time in a programmatic way, we define a fixing. So we define what is the value of the given underlying XYZ at the correct date, which is here. So we say the value known, because it has been seen on the market, is 3650. And then we obtain a contract, which is the simplified contract, because before we had a symbolic expression, and this symbolic expression has been replaced by 150, which is the result of the difference between 3650 and the strike that appeared to be 3500. So we have a simplified contract. So in the system, when time goes on, when uncertainty resolves, the contracts are simplified. Of course, symbolic contract manipulations are very interesting in other domains, in other usages also. We have seen, for instance, automatically decompose a contract into its bond and option part, symbolic netting, calculating some symbolic approximations to some contracts, and this kind of things, and that we do. A contract debugger, where the user is able to play, to simulate very easily the values taken of the inputs and to immediately see the results of the contract. And here, just to have an example of that, how this appears in the GUI, the user has here some things where with the mouse he can change the evolution, the future evolution of the underlyings, and he sees immediately the realized cash flows for this contract. So what is important here is not this nice feature here, which of course is something that some of our competitors also have, of course, is that everything here is generated in a generic way for any contract that is put in. So the program, the system is analyzing what are the underlyings that appear in the contract. It is therefore building up this. It is building up this GUI where you can choose exactly these underlyings, and then it is playing, if you want, it is immediately executing symbolically the contract each time you are moving the lines. Now, about pricing. Pricing, we could say so much that we could be here for 2 days. So I restrict this to one slide. But as some people have mentioned earlier, valuation is never fast enough in finance, never. Because if you multiply the speed by 2 and you proudly bring this to your client, you will immediately have a trader or whatever that will invent a new risk analysis that takes 2 more time, and so you have lost everything. So it's never speedy enough, okay? Because finance is using resource-hungry approaches, typically Monte Carlo methods, or you have to solve partial differential equations, so it's not completely true. So here we are, and this was one of the important points of LexiFi since its creation, we are in fact doing runtime code generation, meaning that we are analyzing a contract and then we are generating the payoff specific part, or more or less the little code part which represents the logic of the payoff of the contract and which is linked with the model for execution. So this means, in our word, we don't have any interpretative overhead when we calculate the price of a contract. We are fully in native speed. Of course, the compilation step the first time takes a little bit time, of course, but everything you can optimize, everything you can do, the smallest thing, has a fantastic result because the Monte Carlo code is executed typically 500,000 times, 1 million times, etc. So we are not speaking about little optimization gains. Of course, there are some clever caching algorithms, etc., so that we don't need to recompile when this is not necessary. And of course, we use here the usual compilation techniques and optimizations. So that's also something, it's a game without end, and that's very nice. So it's also a way to always have nice PhD students and always now nice people who are working on this kind of things, making some trials, etc. And we have also some kind of domain-specific optimizations, because of course some typical kind of patterns always come back again, and which are specific to finance, and you don't find them in physics or biology or whatever. Functional programming techniques at LexiFi, again, we suspect that we are one of the less exotic users, industrial users of functional programming. So no fancy stuff about cloud programming, big data, hardware design, program analysis, like most of the time. Just a domain-specific language with a few tools, a few methodologies, or a few methods which are applied to the algebra we we are using. So here, just very quickly, LexiFi milestones. And so about this slide here, I would simply say the following. This slide is done against all typical rules of a slide. Never, no serious people is doing a slide where you have, what, 20 lines. I think the last people cannot even read this. But it's not so important. It's just for giving you a kind of flavor and for showing you that things are not done in one day. It's a hard work. And there are kind of two interpretations of this kind of slides. The first slide is to say, oh yes, Jean-Marc, he's nice, he gives us some hints, he shows us how to do it. Or the, and the second interpretation is what I call some kind of technological terrorism, is to say to people who are in the room and who could try to do something similar, guys, it's a very, very difficult road and it will be very difficult for you to be serious competitors to LexiFi. So I have seen this kind of interpretation, so I let you see. But the important point here is that these milestones, there's a mixture between technical achievements and of course commercial achievements where we have new clients or new kind of clients, etc., etc. We have an internal project which is called Algebra 3, and which the idea is to input everything we learned during the 10 years to create an enhanced version of our algebra, which is more user-friendly, which allows more end users to program easily. That's a problem. So lessons learned from marketing and sales. So here, of course, as I had put this in the title of my talk, I said myself, I must find very intelligent things to say to you, etc., etc. After having thought very much about all this, I saw that everything I say to you here is available in many good marketing books. So the only thing I can say to you mostly is here that even if most of us are technical guys, etc., reading some marketing book is not bad. Of course, as most marketing book writers are not software writers or even DSL language designers, you should take some assertions with care. You should not think about everything. But the important thing is what we have really experienced during LexiFi's nearly 15 years of existence is that it is very difficult, for not saying impossible, to sell, I would say, a language, a compiler, interpreter, workbench, or integrated development environment, or this very technical stuff without being able to show an end user product. Because of course, we firstly had the technology, we firstly had this language before having this application. I showed you some screenshots. So it is very, very difficult, nearly impossible. Only early adopters will do, and they are very, very rare. Especially much more rarer than you think, because most of them, you know them before you create your company, because it's some kind of relationships, you have some friends, etc., etc. And you think that this can be extrapolated to the industry, and most of the time it's not the case. However, once you have such an end user product, then that you can show and where you can prove that it is built with the technology, then you have much, it's much more easy to sell it, but you need it. Other things that we discovered very frequently is that some features are completely necessary for a demo. Prospects are asking for it and they are killing you if you don't have it, even if this feature is never used in production. That's a mystery, but you have to devote some resources, some energy to create some functionality which is never used in production. But your marketing or your sales guys are very happy with that. Of course, 95% of prospects are in no way interested in DSLs or nice techniques. They just want features. And even the argument that you say to them, yes, but having a good technology will enable me to better serve you in 2 years, 3 years, etc., is not really an argument. It's mysterious for me, but it's not an argument. And yes, 90% of clients will not use the product the like you think, you thought. And so client interaction, feedback, visits is real essential. And this is something I downplayed at the beginning when I created LexiFi, and it was an error. So it's really fundamental. Having clients which agree to speak with you, to interact with you, has a very, very high value. Very important. So one last element I wanted to mention is about forthcoming regulation, forthcoming how do we see or how do we think this this industry will evolve. So firstly, there was a nice idea which was put out by the SEC in April 2010, so following the financial crisis, and about the asset-backed securities, which is a kind of complex contract kind, where for the first time I have seen a financial regulatory body suggest that market participants should provide an executable specification of the contract in the form here of a Python program, and this has been written in a report. I think probably it is clear that the SEC is not a specialist about languages and specification languages. Why Python? And of course, it has been very much discussed then on many blogs, etc. Why Python? There was an absence of formal semantics of Python, that Python was not so easily available, was not available on all platforms, and this kind of things. But it is, for me, one of the first times I have seen in the finance industry, major technology as a regulatory tool, I would say. And even if, of course, the Python idea, I think, is bad, but this idea of having an executable specification is something we, of course, argue very much for. Recent perceived evolutions, now here we are speaking about the last 2-3 years, of course, following the crisis, is that as the AEG episode, which I showed at the completely at the beginning, shows, the inside people, the trader who are working at these kind of companies, have little incentive to make the system clearer, to make it well documented. That's also the difficulty you have if you try to sell this kind of system of tier one banks, investment banks. Of course, over the past decade, I would say there has been not a very strong movement in enhancing this situation. However, in the last 2-3 years, we have seen beginning of a change of that, and of course there's much more obligation now to publish things, to put things on central repositories and this kind of things. Of course, it's done, we think, often with the bad technology. It's done often only with it's only a subset of what should be done, but it's the beginning of a movement. So we are not losing hope about one day some kind of standardization, not of financial contracts, but of description of financial contracts. So of course, it's a little bit an easy conclusion, but at LexiFi we are quite convinced that only the combination of a rigorous finance theory, of course, a strong numerical implementation, I didn't speak about that today, and then a framework where you can symbolically manipulate your financial contracts, can bring a scalable and long-term solution to many, many problems we see in the financial industry. Thank you very much.
So I had a question about, I guess, regulation and also this idea of combinators. Do the combinators that you have, do they have a corresponding legal definition? So for choice or for...
Currently, LexiFi has not really published this in an open way so that you can obtain it or that anybody can look at that. Not so much because we want to be in a secrecy and to keep it because it's a strategic advantage. For us, it would be much more important that it would be popularized, especially what I say often inside LexiFi. If a big player, let's say IBM or whatever, would suddenly use this kind of approach, it would credibilize us. It would be very good. It's simply once you publish things, you can no more change them. We are currently still doing some adaptations. We are then, etc., etc. So no, there's no legal stuff. And currently, contrary to what we hope to, this system is not currently seriously used for exchanging information between two different institutions. It's used inside one institution, yes, to have a universal description of contracts that can be shared between risk department, between compliance department, between front office, back office, but not between two different institutions.
Do you actually generate a contract that two parties can agree to? And if so, you must have legal wording that goes along with those operators that has well-defined meanings in the legal.
A legal description of the contract is supposed to be the term sheet. Because the term sheet is something which takes, I would say, 4 or 5 pages typically, and then it's followed by 50 pages of legalize. Saying also what happens if an underlying disappears and all these kind of things. We have made tryings in generating automatically an English description from our formal representations. We did not achieve to obtain something really usable if you go further than simple examples. We don't have currently. But you see, it's a very general problem. It's take two C programs. How can you prove that they implement the same semantics? Yeah.
How much does Keynote take involve in your rules and contracts? I'm assuming just an assumption
that you're in. So FPML, firstly, I am not well informed about the latest developments of FPML. I have followed it up to a few years ago. If I'm not wrong, but maybe I'm saying something wrong and you have to correct me. FPML is essentially a specification of how to exchange contract parameters. How to exchange the disk. You say there's a swap. A swap definition contains a maturity, of course, much more than that. There you have 120, etc. But it's a specification of parameterized instruments, but you are supposed to read ISDA definitions on the side. FPML is not self-contained. You cannot, by reading an FPML document alone, you don't know what the contract is doing. So that's one thing. Second thing, FPML as an exchange vector. We have been asked sometimes to create a bridge between our system and FPML. By creating, you see, for instance, typically, it would be, let me just come back here. So you see, here you have some kind of parameters, all these parameters, and probably you could translate this into an XML document which would be FPML compatible. We have been asked sometimes by some future clients to do it, and we have never been asked again to do it. They are asking about the possibility, but they are not asking us to really do it. So we don't know exactly.
So this is not defined in XML. how would they report to the repositories, for example,
That's all the problem. Do we agree that it's not really FPML related? It's simply that the repository accepts a finite set of structures, and if you have a structure which is not in this finite set, you cannot report it. Pierre. So yeah, we have, of course, here we can generate XML. We have many ways to produce text documents from that, but it's not FPML. Now, we are not solving this problem. If a given infrastructure is supporting a fixed set of structures, it cannot receive something for what it is. What we argue, of course, is that this kind of central repositories should be much more flexible than just FPML, and they should accept some kind of not our system, but any other system of this combinatorial approach.
Does this relate to and are familiar with FIBO, the financial business ontology?
I have to admit that I don't know well this thing.
Do you know of the thing? You know of it?
Yes, of course. Right. I know of it from the name, not much more than that. You have to make me a crash course on that. Okay, good. I would be very happy.
I don't know if they've gone to the length. They're not going to these lengths. They do not have the descriptive power. In FIBO, in its description.
No, but they describe a lot of the same things.
They describe a lot of the same things, yes, but, all this logic about, you exercise here and this happens, this flows here, they're not trying to capture that in FIBO.
So when you're selling the product, you find that most companies are just trying to choose one core language to base their technology off of, and then they'll translate to an FPML or fix. And so they're kind of shopping around for what that golden source of information is going to be. Or do you see that companies are willing to maintain multiple representations?
What we have seen in the market, and I think that we begin to see many different kinds of situations, is that maintaining different sources always brings horrible problems, and it doesn't work. It doesn't work. What we have seen, of course, is some kind of heterolict system where one say, for instance, we keep our legacy system, Mysis, Murex, Calypso, all these names, and we maintain in them the fact that there exists a contract which is called Mickey Mouse 23, but it's just a pointer to a contract definition in the LexiFi system. There are no two descriptions. There are some pointers where one system is delegating to the other system some part of the management of the manipulation of the contract. That's we have seen and we see very often, but not two coexisting definition. No, they're always discrepancies. Sorry.
So yeah. So on that note, you briefly touched on the fact that the regulators are looking for some way to have an executable description of contract. And that means that at some point they might move towards some standardization. They tried with Python, maybe that's people have pushed back on that. But that means that eventually they're moving towards having declaring that there is some official way to express these details, these semantics about a contract. And then if it's not the same language, then you just have to do a translation, right?
Yes. And this would we don't await that our way will be chosen for standardizing the world. Of course not. But we say that we would prefer a standardization, a good standardization of course, to no standardization at all. because we can, of course, translate from one semantics to the other.
Right, sure. One syntax to the other.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we are doing, of course, with our small little possibilities, we are trying to contact the regulators more in Europe than in the US, of course, for evident reasons. We visited the European Commission, and this was very interesting because we did a presentation about the importance of having this kind of specification and to be able to manage the contracts in a good way from creation to inception, etc. And in front of five very polite persons, very nice, etc. And they told us, more or less, we are quite sure that this exists in the industry. We cannot imagine that it does not exist. They thought that we were just trying to sell them something trivial, which has been sold many times. And so they said to us, yes, your system size seems to be very nice. We understand it. We are quite convinced that it is used everywhere. And so it was very polite, handshaking, etc. Bye-bye. That was our contact with the European, with one European regulator. We are taking contact with American regulators also. It takes much time, of course. And we are foreigners. That's good.
And your chief concern, I'm sorry.
Just ask them to call the European regulator. They tell them it's used all over Europe.
And just one nice thing about this, proposition here, which was then open and people could put in commands, and this was a big blog and adding, and from a guy I didn't know in any way, he put just the following comment: the SEC should buy LexiFi and put everything in open source, and then the problem is solved. It is clear that the fact I am here today shows you that this did not happen. So we are still here in trying to explain to the regulators how we think things should be standardized.
So your key concern there is that whatever they choose as a standard is sufficiently and accurately expressive, right?
Yeah, but not yet. It must be sufficiently expressive. But this is something where I have no doubts, because industry participants will immediately cry if the system that is suggested is too small. But much more important is it should not be too big. It should be small enough so that we can continue to apply some tools that, of course, we have many of our transformations, many of our static analysis, etc., could not be done in a general programming framework because algorithms would diverge or what, blah, 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 blah. But because we have an algebra which is very small, where I don't go into details, but where we have this time which goes only in one direction, etc., we have convergence of many algorithms, which is guaranteed. And this is important that we keep that. And of course, people were saying to you, we should just use VBA or Excel or C or Python, etc. They are not thinking about these kind of things. And that's the danger.
Okay, let's go ahead and thank Jean-Marc again.